right, let's get started. Today we're going to do chapter 3. Going to talk about bonding in molecular and ionic compounds. And then we're going to do nomenclature of each type of compound. Molecular and ionic compounds. Basically, these differ in the way that they bond. Methane is an example of a molecular compound. Carbon in the middle, four hydrogens attached. These are what are called covalent bonds. In a covalent bond, the atoms are sharing electrons. This is sodium chloride. This is an example of an ionic compound. And as we'll see in these, we have full transfer of electrons to form charged particles. Covalent bonds can be single, they can be double, and they can be triple. This is an example of ethene. Here we have single bonds from carbon to hydrogen, and we have a representation of a double covalent bond between two carbons. Remember, every bond that's shown in a diagram like this represents two shared electrons. For ionic compounds, sodium chloride, like I said, sodium will transfer one electron to a chlorine. That leaves the sodium ion positive. Positive ion is called a cation, and leaves the chlorine negative. That's an anion. We'll go over these in more detail in a minute. Again, transfer one electron from sodium to chlorine, wind up with a positive sodium and a negative chlorine. Now, we talked about electron configuration, and we use carbon as an example. Carbon is in the second period here, right here, position number 4 going over. That means that the first shell up here, so period number 1, is filled. We have 1, 2, 3, 4 electrons in the second shell. This is meant to be a carbon atom. 1s2, 2s2, 2p2. The electrons that are shown in the inside here are what we refer to as core electrons. They're there, they have to be there, but nobody really cares because they don't do anything. They're simply core electrons. They're the totally filled shells. The electrons that are much more interest are these guys in the outer shell, and these are called valence electrons. These are the highest energy electrons. And the reason we care about these are the guys that we use to make bonds. Carbon will form covalent bonds. That means that it will share these 4 electrons that are out here with other atoms. First of all, let's start off with something that was done many years ago by Lewis in an attempt to explain bonding and to explain why things bonded to so many, certain number of other atoms. This is a Lewis dot structure. What Lewis said is we're going to take the chemical symbol and then we're going to put little dots around it to represent the valence electrons. So those are the highest energy electrons. Ignore the core, only the valence. So carbon, as our example, we would look at carbon right here in our second period. We have 1, 2, 3, 4 valence electrons. So we'd start off with a C. Remember, the valence electrons are the highest energy. That's the top period here. And we have a total of 4. In Lewis's little mechanism. We put dots around the carbon to represent each of these. So, the rule is, you put dots singly around there until you get four, and then you start to pair them up. Carbon can form a bond, a covalent bond, by sharing each of these separate electrons. Look at another example. How about fluorine? Fluorine, once again, is a second period element. That means the first is filled, that's our core electrons. And on our second, we have 1, 2 in the S, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in the P. Total of 7 valence electrons. So we would write an F. Then we would put 4 electrons around it singly. Then we would start to pair them. We have 3 more electrons. And this would be the Lewis dot structure for fluorine. Now, it's important, and people are often confused, and say things like, well, what if I put the single electron here or wherever? Doesn't matter. Lewis dot structure is simply a bookkeeping method. Bookkeeping to allow covalent bonds. Any way you draw this is fine, as long as you have 3 pairs and 1 single. Any questions? Well, you might wonder if there's a simple way to know how many valence electrons you're dealing with, because we want to keep it simple. There is. We simply have to look at our periodic table. As you look at the periodic table, remember we have periods going down, and we have these 8 groups up here going across. The group number will correspond to the number of valence electrons. So anything in group 1 will have 1 valence electron. Magnesium, for example, in group 2 has 2, so does beryllium, so does calcium. Over here in group 3, boron with 3, aluminum with 3. Group 4, carbon, silicon, all have 4. Valence electrons. It continues. Over here in group 5, phosphorus, nitrogen, etc. These guys all have 5 valence electrons. Group 6, we have selenium, sulfur, oxygen with 6. Group 7, these are halogens. These are very important. We're going to use halogens a lot. And it's really important that you know that the group 7s are the halogens, very reactive compounds, and they all have 7 valence electrons. By the time we get to group 8, we have 8 valence electrons, and we can't put any more in there, can we? Because all of the orbitals are filled. That's why inert gases don't undergo simple reaction. You need unpaired electrons in order to form bonds. Any question on the concept? We can use a Lewis dot structure to show charged particles, charged atoms. Now, these are what we find in ionic compounds. As we said before, a positively charged atom is going to be called a cation, and a negatively charged atom is called an anion. If you want to draw the Lewis structure for an ion, you follow the same rules except you either add or subtract electrons. So let's do this. Chloride anion. Chlorine is over here in group 7. It's in the third period, but it still has 7 valence electrons. If we want to make chloride anion, this is chlorine with 1 negative charge, what we would do is simply start with our symbol, and we would put the 7 electrons around it. This is neutral. In order to make this the anion, that's 1 negative charge, we simply have to add 1 electron. We wind up with a chloride anion. We now have 8 electrons around the chlorine and a negative charge. You'll notice, I hope, that what we have done is move the electron configuration of chlorine from here, where it started, over to here, where it matches the inert gas argon. Now, it's still chlorine because it still has the same number of protons. Remember, that's the only thing that matters. But as far as electrons goes, it matches argon. Any questions?
What does that mean?
Argon has full octet, 8 electrons in its valence shell. Okay? That's what makes argon an inert gas. Remember, you need single electrons to form covalent bonds. When we fill them all up, this is acting electronically like an inert gas. We'll see that this is called the octet rule. Let's do sulfide dianion. Step 1, you look at your periodic table and find sulfur. Sulfur is here in group 6, which means it has 6 valence electrons. We would put the 6 electrons around the sulfur. Go ahead and do that. Fun to play along. Remember, because there's 6 electrons, we have 2 pairs and 2 single electrons. We don't pair them up until we get 4 everywhere and then start pairing. In order to make the dianion, -2, we simply need to add 2 electrons. And we would write this as sulfur with a -2 charge. Doesn't matter if you write -2 or 2-. Most books would use 2-, but it doesn't matter to me. Any questions? Well, let's do the same thing with nitrogen. Nitrogen will form a trianion. So nitrogen is here in group 5, that means it has 5 valence electrons. Start by drawing a symbol. And then you're going to put electrons around it. Put your 5 around. Remember, go 1 at a time, then pair it up. And that should leave you something like this. 1 pair and 3 single electrons. Now, to get a trianion, we simply have to add 3 electrons. We show this as a nitrogen with a -3 charge. We'll see in a little bit that we call this a nitride, IDE, anion.
let's don't just talk about anions. How about a cation? A sodium cation. Sodium is over here in group 3. It has one valence electron. In the third period, group 1, one valence electron. So, to write the sodium cation, you'd start off by writing the Lewis structure for sodium. There's our symbol. And we have one electron. Now, to make this positive, to make it a cation, we have to remove that electron. It's going to be donated to something else, but we have to get rid of it. When we do, we have more protons than we do electrons, and therefore we have a positive charge. Any questions on how to do these? Start off with a symbol, look at the group number, put electrons around it one at a time, then pair them up. Then you want to either add or subtract electrons to get your ion. All right, let's see what we've been doing here. An atom that has 8 valence electrons matches these inert gases. First level here can only accommodate 2 electrons. Remember that? So 2 electrons is the magic number for group 1. I'm sorry, period 1. This is called the octet rule. Once we put 8 electrons around an atom, it becomes unreactive. It becomes equivalent to one of these inert gases. First thing we did was chlorine. We put one electron around it to make chloride. And that gave us from chlorine to the electronic configuration of argon. It makes it react, it's still a chlorine, but it makes it react as if it was an argon. For sulfur, we started off here in group 6, right here. We added 2 electrons to make a dianion. That moved it from here, again, over to the configuration of argon. 8 electrons around the atom. Sodium. We started here with sodium. We took this electron away. So now we have no electrons in the third period, but we match up with the second period here at neon. The whole goal of the exercise is to wind up with 8 unreactive electrons around your atom. Now we're going to do this 2 ways. One is by making ions, like we've done. We're going to add electrons or take them away to make a charged atom. The other way we're going to achieve an octet is by sharing electrons with something else. So let's go back to our friend chlorine. This is chlorine, it's in group 7, it has 7. Valence electrons. If we had a little vial of chlorine and we didn't sniff it and all die, which we would, see that chlorine exists as 2 atoms of chlorine stuck together. Now why is that? That's because they form a covalent bond between each other and share the electrons. So what's happening here, this is one chlorine sitting here with its 7. We bring in this other chlorine. suddenly, because we can count the shared electrons twice, this chlorine looks and says, I've got 8 electrons around me, I'm happy. This guy also looks and says, I have 8 electrons, and I'm happy too.
This is how we form a covalent bond. We share electrons so that each atom will have 8. Only exception is if you have a hydrogen. Hydrogen is in the first period. Remember, we can only have 2 around it. That makes it equivalent to helium.
Now, when we write a covalent bond,
instead of writing lots and lots of little dots, because that gets really old really fast,
we tend to abbreviate a covalent bond with a line. Whenever you see a line between atoms, that represents 2 shared electrons. So this chlorine has 2, 4, 6, 8. This guy has 2, 4, 6, 8 electrons.
This is how we're going to build molecules. Any question on the concept? Well, let's build a simple molecule then.
How about ammonia? Ammonia has a nitrogen in the middle and 3 hydrogens around it.
If we were to draw the Lewis structure of ammonia, we would strive to make sure the nitrogen had 8 electrons and each hydrogen had 2.
Start off by finding them on the periodic table. Nitrogen is here in group 5, so it has 5 valence electrons. So you can put it in down on your paper with 5 little dots around it, 2 of them paired up. Hydrogen is here in group 1. It has 1 valence electron. So you need 3 hydrogens, each with 1 dot. What we've got is something like this. Here's our nitrogen with its 5, 3 hydrogens, each having 1.
Now,
next thing you're going to do is scooch these guys together. Remember, it takes 2 electrons to make a covalent bond. If we move all the atoms together, we get something like this.
If you look at this now, this central nitrogen has
2, 4, 6, 8 electrons. 3 of them are shared, and each hydrogen has 2.
If we were to draw this using the line bond method, that's what it's called,
we would draw something like this. 3 covalent bonds. Nitrogen still has an unshared pair of electrons. That's important nomenclature. This is an unshared pair of electrons.
You'll see that the chemistry of nitrogen is basically dictated by the reactivity of these electrons. Any questions?
Well, let's do something a little more challenging. How about nitrogen?
Nitrogen is a gas. It exists as a diatomic molecule in 2.
All right, we know nitrogen is here. It's in our second period in the 5th group. So each nitrogen starts off with 5 electrons. Go ahead and write that. And you should have something like this. Now the challenge is to pair up these electrons forming covalent bonds so that each nitrogen has 8 electrons. So here's what we have. 2 nitrogens, each with 5 electrons. Clearly, we could make a bond between these two, right? That would give us 2, 4, 6 total electrons. That's not enough. Now remember I said that covalent bonds can exist as single, that would be 1 pair of electrons, double, or even triple bonds. So let's take this and fiddle with it a little bit. I'm going to grab this electron and move it in between the 2 nitrogens. Likewise, I'm going to grab this one and move it over here so we can pair with the one we just put there. Now, if we add them up, we would have 2, 4, 6, 7 electrons on each nitrogen. That's better, but we're still not there yet, are we? Let's take this last pair that's dangling here at the bottom and move it up. Now, we have 1 single bond here, 1 bond here, 1 bond here. We have 6, 7, 8 electrons around each nitrogen. So we've done this by making a triple covalent bond. So this is what we started with. We moved these guys in, moved these guys in, and we wound up with this. Again, 6, 7, 8 electrons around this nitrogen, 6, 7, 8 electrons around that nitrogen. This is an example of a triple covalent bond. We would use line bond nomenclature, and we would write it like this. Remember, each dash here represents 2 shared electrons. Any questions? All right, nitrogen and chlorine and methane, the ones that we've talked about, are examples of what we call molecular compounds. They're held together using covalent bonds. How do you know if we're going to form a molecular compound or an ionic compound? Remember when we talked about the periodic table and how colorful it can be? I pointed out that many periodic tables were colored to indicate metals, semi-metals, and non-metals. The purplish-blue stuff here, we said all of these are metals. The yellows are all, including hydrogen, non-metals. And the little green guys here in the middle, these are semi-metals, semiconductors. A very simple rule of thumb. If you have a compound that contains only non-metals or semi-metals, so these guys, It will be molecular.
If you have something that has a metal ion, it will be ionic. If it has a metal at all, it will be ionic. Otherwise, we have covalent bonds. Very simple.
Yeah, we said that.
So if I told you we had a compound with magnesium and chlorine, would you expect this to be molecular or ionic? What you have to do is simply find the elements. Magnesium is over here in our second group. It's a metal. Chlorine's over here. It's yellow. It's a nonmetal. Our rule is if it contains a metal, it must be ionic. Most properly, this is not molecular, but not molecular transfers to ionic. So this is simple, isn't it? One hydrogen, one fluorine. Step one, find them on the periodic table. Hydrogen is in group 1. Fluorine is in group 7. Hydrogen is yellow. It's a nonmetal. And so is fluorine. If we have only nonmetals in our molecule, it is molecular. One silicon and 4 chlorines. Find your silicon. It's here hiding underneath carbon, and it's green. Fluorine is over here in group 7, and it's yellow. This is a semi-metal, this is a non-metal. If it's non-metals and or semi-metals, we have covalent bonds, and it is molecular. One sodium, one bromine. Sodium is in our first group, right over here. It's as blue as it can be. It's a metal. Chlorine, of course, is here. Bromine is here in group 7. It's a nonmetal. But if we have a metal in there, it is not a molecular compound, and the bonding will be ionic. And this just goes to show that you don't have to have different atoms. Sulfur can exist in many forms. One of its most common forms is 8 sulfurs clustered together. Again, sulfur is here in group 6. It's a nonmetal, which means that all of the bonds in S8 are going to be covalent. And it is molecular. It actually looks like a crown. It's kind of cute. Any questions? Let's just look at a quick assortment here. One of the questions that you will have both in labs and on exams is to identify compounds as molecular or ionic. So quickly run through this list and identify these as molecular or not.
have a nickel and a chlorine. Nickel is down here. It's a transition metal, but it's a metal. Chlorine, of course, is a nonmetal. As long as it has a metal, it is not molecular, and the bonding will be ionic. Dihydrogen sulfide, also called hydrogen sulfide. This is the stuff that makes well water stink. Hydrogen is a nonmetal. Sulfur is a nonmetal. This is a molecular compound. One silicon and four hydrogens. Silicon, group four, right there under carbon. It is a semi-metal. Hydrogen, of course, is a nonmetal. This is molecular. One sulfur, three oxygens. Sulfur, right here. Oxygen, right above it. They're both nonmetals. It is molecular. And calcium with two hydrogens. Calcium is over here in our second group. Hydrogen, of course, is up here, but that's a metal, making this not molecular. Let me hush for a moment. Go ahead and do these one more time. Our first one has cesium and oxygen. Cesium is right here in our first group. Oxygen is over here. It's a metal, but I'm sorry, non-metal, but this is a metal. It is not a molecular compound. One iodine, seven oxygens. Iodine is here, oxygen is here. This is molecular. Covalent bonds. Kind of like off. Oxygen right here, fluorine right next to it. They're both nonmetals. Carbon with four hydrogens. Carbon is here in group four. It's a nonmetal. Hydrogen, of course, we recognize as a nonmetal. This is molecular. This is methane that we saw earlier. All the bonds are covalent. And finally, sodium chloride. Sodium is right there. It's a metal, group one. Chlorine is over here. It is, of course, ionic and not molecular. Any questions? All right, let's look at molecules or compounds that are not molecular first. So these are the ionic ones. We've seen that we can form these by transferring electrons from one atom to another, but there's an entire class of ionic compounds that use something called a polyatomic ion. In a polyatomic ion, we will typically have a cation that usually is a metal, and then we will have an anion that is several different atoms held together by covalent bonds. So it's kind of a hybrid, but they clump together just like an ionic compound. These are called polyatomic ions. Again, it's a group of atoms bonded together in covalent bonds that will have a net charge. These combine with simple ions to give more complex ionic compounds. An example, strontium sulfate. Strontium is over here in the periodic table in our second group. Sulfate is going to be a polyatomic ion consisting of one sulfur and four oxygens. Now remember, sulfur and oxygen, right here, are both nonmetals, so all of these bonds are covalent. Strontium sulfate, there's our one strontium. This is what sulfate looks like. Sulfur in the middle, four oxygens around. These are all covalent bonds. Sulfate will have a minus two charge, and these two pair up. One strontium, one sulfate to form a compound. Again, this is electrostatic bonding. So the positives and the negatives simply attract each other. Depending upon the geometry, they will pack together in the most efficient way, and that gives us a crystal. We'll see that in a few minutes. All right, so this is sulfate. Sulfate is perhaps the easiest one. There are many polyatomic ions. Now, we don't have to know all of these, but probably most of them. Okay? And yeah, there are a lot. You kind of have to memorize them. As a rule of thumb, you need to know the ones we talk about in class. I'm not going to talk about all of them, but you need to know them. Now, sometimes this is a little daunting for people. So let me just tell you now, I don't want to spoil your surprise, but when it comes time for the exam, everyone is allowed to bring a 3x5 card. You can write on both sides, put anything you want on it. You could put all these guys, but you'd be wasting a card. So don't panic. There's a simple way around this. All right, let's look at these guys. When we have a typical oxygen-containing polyatomic ion, we're going to define what's known as the parent. The parent is going to end in the suffix ATE. We're going to put a prefix that is the prefix of the atom. So, for chlorine, got ahead of myself. If it ends in ATE without any other prefix, this is the parent of the group. If we add one additional oxygen, we're going to put a per in front. So this is going to keep the eight suffix per in front. It'll be a per something eight. If we have one less oxygen, we're going to call it an ITE as our suffix. And if we have two less oxygens, it's a hypoite. Now the neat thing about it is that for each major group, all of these are going to have the same charge. They're just going to differ by the number of oxygens relative to the parent. Again, the parent ends in 8. Put a per for one more, ITE for one less, hypoite for 2. Look at a real example. Let's do chlorine. The prefix is going to be chlor. That's the root. Okay? We call the parent chlor 8. Now chlorate, ClO3, one chlorine in the middle, three oxygens around, has a negative charge. If we add one more oxygen, we get perchlorate. Take one away, take two away. So perchlorate, keep the 8, put our per in front, that tells you one more oxygen. Down here, we take one oxygen away. This is chlorite, ITE, one less oxygen. And hypochlorite, hypo tells us we have two less oxygens in the parent, and it looks like this. Again, all of these, all the chlorine-containing ions will have a minus one charge. That makes it easy. Nitrogen. There are two that we're going to deal with. The parent is nitrate. If we take one oxygen away, we get nitrite.
Now, polyatomic ions are typically negative. They're anions. There is one cation that we're going to use in the class, and it is a derivative of nitrogen.
It's a nitrogen with four hydrogens and a positive charge. This is called ammonium. Need to know all of these guys for sure.
Sulfur containing, we've already seen sulfate.
Take one oxygen away, we get sulfite. These are both minus two.
Now we can do something a little different.
Hydrogen basically is a proton. It's a positive charge. If we take our sulfate, so it looks like this, and simply put a hydrogen on one of these oxygens, no matter which, we get hydrogen sulfate with one less negative charge. Do the same thing with sulfite. As far as nomenclature goes, hydrogen and sulfite or sulfate are two separate words.
Phosphorus.
Our parent is phosphate, and we can do phosphite. Here's what it looks like. We can put one hydrogen on and call it hydrogen phosphate. We can put two hydrogens on and call it dihydrogen phosphate. Same thing with phosphite, either one or two hydrogens. All of these guys are going to start off at minus three. These are minus two. Nitrogen and chlorine were minus one. And for every hydrogen, we take away one charge. Couple more. Carbon. Carbonates the parent. Minus two. There is no carbonite. That was in Star Wars. Okay? But it's not real. We can put a hydrogen in front and call it hydrogen carbonate. This is also called bicarbonate. Sodium bicarbonate, baking soda, that's what that is. Sodium hydrogen carbonate. Acetate, you probably won't use until you hit general chemistry. Cyanide, carbon nitrogen with a triple bond between them. This is cyanide with a minus one.
Now, let's look a little bit at how we build a polyatomic. And we're going to do this using Lewis structures.
So let's start off with something like chlorate anion. Chlorate anion. This is the parent for the chlorine group. All the chlorine groups have one negative charge. we're going to draw a Lewis structure. Chlorine in the middle, three oxygens around, and a negative charge. So we've done this with ammonia. We can do that. Fine. Your atoms, chlorine's here, oxygen's here. 7 electrons on the chlorine. Each oxygen has 6. Go ahead, write them down. Oxygens with 6 each. The way I've got it drawn should be upsetting to you. This looks like we have 3 electrons in between these atoms. We know we can only do 2 or 4 or 6. Can't do an odd number. So what I'm going to do is simply take one of these electrons and move it up and pair it with this guy. Same thing here. And move this one down, pair it up here. So we wind up with an intermediate structure now that will look like that. Again, magic. Here we had them all in between. And all I'm doing is moving it up, moving it up, moving it down to get this. Now why did I do that? Because now we're left with 2 electrons between this chlorine and oxygen. 2 electrons here, we can make a bond. Only place that we seem to be deficient is this bond here. We only have 1 electron, don't we? But chlorate is an anion. That means it has 1 extra electron. So what you're going to do is add the extra electron to the central atom, that's the chlorine. So from somewhere, we come up with an electron, stick it in there. Now this whole group has a negative charge. Let's scooch the atoms together. This oxygen has 8 electrons. It's happy. This one has 8. This one has 8. They're all happy. If we look at the chlorine in the middle, it has 2, 4, 6, 8. Even the chlorine is happy. The whole complex together has a -1 charge because we added 1 additional electron. If we draw this with line bond, it would look like this. 1 bond, 1 bond, 1 bond. Each of these are 2 electrons, these guys, with a net negative charge. That's how you build a polyatomic ion. All of those that we looked at are built in a very similar way. All of the bonds in there are covalent. And we've simply added additional electrons so that everything has an octet. Any questions? Well, the octet rule is kind of neat. It's a nice guideline. But just like all rules, there are exceptions. And these are called, quote, exceptions to the octet rule. Let's look at sulfur with 4 fluorines. This is what the molecule looks like in space. And let's count up the electrons on the sulfur. We have 2 for this bond. That's 4. That's 6. That's 8. And we have 2 more. That's 10. 10 electrons. Now, how in the world did that happen, huh? Let's go ahead and build it. start off with our sulfur over here with 6 electrons, 4 fluorines with 7 each. Go ahead and draw them out with the sulfur in the middle. Lots of little dots here, but here's our sulfur with its 2, 4, 6, and each of these fluorines has 7. Now right away, you could look at this and say, all right, I've done this before, we can do this. I see we can make a bond here, we can make a bond here, no problem. But by George, we have 3 electrons in between each of these. No simple place to put them, is there? So, what I'm going to do is simply grab 2 electrons. Hello. There you go. I'm going to grab these 2 electrons, and I'm just going to put them in, quote, storage. I'm going to put them over here somewhere. They're gone. Now it suddenly looks clear, doesn't it? We can make a bond here, 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 and here. 4 nice bonds. Let's do that. But don't forget, we still have these electrons sitting over here in the cabinet. We have to put them back. Gotta put them back on the sulfur. Now we have 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 electrons on our sulfur. This is called valence expansion. Valence expansion is possible for any element in the third period and below. The first 2 don't do it, but anything from the third down can do it. Once again, this is what it looks like. In general chemistry, you will learn why this molecule looks this way. It has to do with valence shell repulsion. This is actually hybridized, and what you will find out someday is an sp3d orbital. You don't need to know that now, though. But what we do is combine orbitals and make a region of space where all these electrons can live. Any questions? Let's do one more example of an exception to the octet rule. 1 boron, 3 hydrogens. Go ahead and write it out. Boron is over here in group 3, so it has 3 valence electrons. Hydrogen, group 1, it has 1 valence electron. There's our boron. And we put 3 hydrogens around it.
All right, we know what to do next. We're going to scooch them together.
Now we're going to convert these into line bonds.
Except that we note
4 boron only has 2, 4, 6 valence electrons. Each hydrogen has 2, so they're happy.
But the boron sitting in the middle is very unhappy.
In general chemistry, you will learn that this guy is what's called a Lewis acid. It's an electron acceptor. Why is it an electron acceptor? Because it has this big gaping hole here. It desperately wants electrons. When you use BH3, BH3 is a tough compound to use in the lab. It is flammable. In moist air, it bursts into flames instantly. You typically store it in something like ether. This is the organic compound dimethyl ether. So BH3 comes in a solution of ether. Why ether? This is oxygen. Oxygen has 2, 4, 6, 8 electrons. It's happy. And it has 2 unshared pairs. What it does is it will donate one of these pairs to the boron. You'll form a complex like this. And this stabilizes the poor boron by making it think it has electrons. Called a covalent coordinate bond. Again, this is general chemistry stuff. Any questions? All right, let's talk a little bit more about ionic compounds. We said we have a cation, which is positive, an anion, which is negative. This is sodium chloride. Sodium is going to be positive. Chlorine is going to be negative. Each of these will have an octet in their outer shell. That's the driving force. When we put sodium chloride together, they stick together because they're charged, and they tend to form crystal aggregates. This is crystalline sodium chloride. And you'll note that these are really nice little cubes with sharp edges and stuff. That's because when these guys pack, they form a cubic symmetry. The symmetry, again, of the packing dictates the crystal form when they all aggregate together. Now I said that sodium was a +1, chlorine was a -1. How do you know this? Once again, simply look at your periodic table. Let's look at the first 4 groups. Anything in group 1 will form a +1. Group 2 will be a +2. 3 is a +3. And 4 is a +4. So these are the typical ions associated with each of the groups. Now after we do +4, we're going to start adding electrons to make ions. So group 5, nitrogen is here. Nitrogen needs to add 3 electrons to get over here. Oxygen needs to add 2, and fluorine needs to add 1. So these are cations over here, and these are anions over here. Any questions? Now there are a couple rules when we go to pair these things up. One is the principle of charge balance. When you make a compound, it must be neutral. That means the positives and the negatives have to add up. So if we had a magnesium is here in group 2, so it's a +2. Sulfur is over here in group 6, so it's a -2. +2 and -2, the net charge in this compound is 0. Sodium, group 1, bromine, group 7, +1, -1. Once again, we're at 0. Now, if we made a compound with sodium and sulfur is in group 6. It takes two electrons, so it's a minus two. In order to get a neutral compound, that means we need two sodiums to pair with it to give us a zero.
Magnesium, again, is group two, so it's a plus two.
We need two minus ones in order to pair to get zero. Simply call this the principle of charge balance. You've got to pair them up. Now, when you go to write the formula,
we've seen formulas, whatever, as we've done this, but
when we write the formula, we're going to write the ions together, and we're going to do this using the lowest whole number ratio of the atoms. So for magnesium and sulfur, we need one of each. The formula we would write would be MgS. Now if you wrote Mg2S2, it would still be neutral, but it'd be wrong. Lowest whole number ratio. One sodium, one bromine. Again, that works simply NaBr, lowest whole number ratio. Here we have two sodiums and one sulfur. So we show that with our little subscript here. Na2 and 1s. You read this as two sodiums for every sulfur. Same thing with magnesium bromide. One magnesium with a plus two, we need two bromines, and we write it like that. Any questions? Yeah. The net charge is zero, and you always have to use lowest whole number ratios. So if we had written two magnesiums, two sulfurs, it would still be zero, but it's not the lowest ratio. Two things to think about. Just for practice, look at these guys and make sure you can interpret the formulas. NaCl tells us one sodium, one chlorine. HF, one hydrogen, one fluorine. H2O, two hydrogens, one oxygen. And SO4, we've seen that before, haven't we? That's sulfate. If you were to interpret this, you could say two potassiums and one sulfate. That's legal. Or you could break it all the way down, say two potassiums, one sulfur, four oxygens. Make sure you know how to read formulas. One of the standard questions on exams is to give you some bizarre formula and ask you how many atoms there are of each. Standard question. Any questions? All right, let's go ahead and do a couple compounds here. I want a compound with magnesium and chlorine. Go ahead and write the formula. Step one, we have to find them on the periodic table. Magnesium lives here in group two. Chlorine lives here in group 7. So this will be a plus 2. This will be a minus 1. So if we're going to write a compound, we have to write it so it's neutral, right? In order to make this neutral, we would need two minus ones for every plus two. So we could do that simply by writing MgCl2. This one's a little more interesting. Aluminum and oxygen. Find aluminum. Aluminum lives here in group 3. Oxygen is in group 6. Because this is in group 3, it will form a plus 3 cation. Because oxygen is in group 6, it needs 2 electrons, it will form a minus 2 anion. So we have a plus 3 and a minus 2.
Now we have to put these together to form a neutral compound.
You need to find the ratio of aluminum plus 3 and oxygen minus 2 to give us a neutral substance. Now this isn't rocket science, okay, but there's actually a very simple little useful symmetry tool that we're going to learn. This is what we're dealing with. Aluminum plus 3, oxygen minus 2. If you want to know the ratio that works, we have Al and we have O. First of all, look at the charge on your cation. This is going to show up as the subscript for the anion. Look at the charge on the anion. That's the subscript for the cation. So it's a simple crisscross symmetry. Think about it. This is plus 3, we have 2 of them. That's 6 positive charges. This is minus 2, we have 3 of them. That's 6 negative charges.
So simple crisscross symmetry, nice simple way to do this.
Let's do another. Beryllium and selenium.
What's the chemical symbol of beryllium?
Well, here's beryllium, the E. It's in group 2. Selenium is living here underneath sulfur in group 6. So beryllium is going to be a plus 2. Selenium is going to be a minus 2.
Now, what if
we used our crisscross method? Plus 2, minus 2, cation down here, anion down here. We would get this. But of course, instantly we know that's wrong because not the lowest whole number ratio, is it?
So that's where you can get in trouble with the crisscross. If they're the same,
make sure you always go to the lowest whole number ratio. This is beryllium selenide. Here's a model, little beryllium in the middle, big seleniums all around, nice cubic crystal.
Now I hope that you're sitting there saying to yourself, how in the world did he know this was beryllium selenide? Yeah.
So because
Yep, that's it. Lowest whole number ratio.
How did I know it's beryllium selenide? Because we're about to do nomenclature of ionic compounds. Nomenclature of ionic and molecular is slightly different, so we'll do ionic first. Remember again, we have a cation and an anion. We're going to look at elements, we're going to identify the root, and we're going to add ide to the root of the anion. The first word in the name is simply going to be the cation without doing anything to it at all. So that's simple, right? That's simple. Our first element here, the cation, is going to be magnesium. So we simply write the word magnesium. Now our anion is bromine. The root is going to be brome. So we're going to write brome. And to show that it's the anion, we're going to add ID. Magnesium bromide. Now that's simple. Note that we don't use a multiplier to say that we have two bromines. We don't use a multiplier. How are you supposed to know? Well, you're just supposed to know, that's why. You're supposed to look at this and say, yeah, that's plus two, we need two of these guys. So no multipliers. Our next one, sodium is our cation. The root for chlorine is chlor. And we're simply going to add IDE. K is potassium. We have two of them, but we don't care. Sulfur. Our root is sulf. And we simply add IDE. And here we are with a beryllium and two bromines, no multipliers. We write beryllium first. Our root is brome, just like here, and IDE to show it's an anion. Now that's simple. Go ahead and take a minute and quickly jot down the name for each of these guys. On exams, you will be given your very own periodic table, so you don't have to squint at this one. It will not have names on it, however. So it just has the basic information without the name. And it's not colored.
Like, it's just going to have the symbol, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's not colored?
Not colored, no.
Can you color it?
Yes, you may color it. Yeah. No, you can't bring your own. Okay, that's not fair. And you can't have it tattooed on your arm. You know, nothing like that. All right, our first one here, our cation is calcium. We're simply going to write the word calcium. Bromine, so this is bromide. We have aluminum. That's our cation. That's our first word. Oxygen is going to be oxide. Li is lithium. The root for sulfur is sulf, so this is lithium sulfide. Once again, Ca is calcium,
This is oxygen, so this is oxide. Ni is nickel. Ci is chlorine. You could write it this way, nickel chloride, but we'll see in just a few moments, that's wrong. Nickel is here in the middle of the periodic table. It's a transition metal. And we'll see in just a minute, for transition metals, you need to show the charge on the cation. So this is going to be nickel 2 chloride. But that's coming up. Now going this direction is really simple because you don't have to worry about multipliers. All you have to do is stick iodide on the end and whatever. Everyone happy with this? Where this gets a little more complicated is if you go backwards. So go ahead and write the formula for each of these guys. Let's do the first one together. What, you don't have this?
I don't think it's on our slides.
Oh, really? Oh, well, write it somewhere. I changed my presentation virtually every time I give the talk. So sometimes I forget to stick the slide in. I'm sorry. All right, let's do our first one together. Calcium. Calcium is a group 2 metal. So it'll be a plus 2, right? Nitrogen is over here in group 5. It will pick up 3 electrons and be a minus 3. So you do that, okay? Now, how many calciums? How many nitrogens? We can simply do our crisscross, can't we? We have a plus 2 on the calcium. That means we'll need 2 nitrogens. We have a minus 3 on the nitrogen, so we're going to need 3 calciums. 6 positives, 6 negatives. Simply crisscross. Go ahead and look at the rest. Magnesium is in group 2. Oxygen is in group 6. So magnesium is going to be a plus 2, and oxygen will be a minus 2. If we did our crisscross, we would get 2 magnesiums, 2 oxygens, but we know right away we can't do that, right? So we're just going to do MgO. Where does lithium live? Lithium lives in group 1. So it's a plus 1. Iodine is a halogen, so it's in group 7. So it's a minus 1. We have simply a plus 1 and a minus 1. We simply write them together, don't we? Call this lil.
Where does barium live? In group two, right there. Phosphorus is over here in group five. So it needs three electrons, it's a minus three. Barium is a plus two.
Do your crisscross.
How many bariums? Three. And how many phosphorus?
Two.
And finally, beryllium fluoride. Beryllium right here in group two. Fluorine over here in group seven. So this is going to be a plus two, minus one. We need two fluorines for every beryllium. Now that's not difficult, is it? Not at all. So we're going to make it just a little bit more challenging. Remember our friends, the polyatomic ions. Don't tattoo those on your arm either. We can, of course, make ionic compounds with a cation and a polyatomic. The naming is very, very simple. We're going to take our cation, put it first, take the polyatomic with its name, and put it second. This has calcium. CO3 is carbonate. It's simply calcium carbonate. The only polyatomic cation we need to worry about in this course is NH4. Remember what that was called? Ammonium. So this is going to be ammonium. Cl is simply chloride. Our cation in the next one is sodium. SO4, we remember, is called sulfate. And this is simply sodium sulfate. If SO4 is sulfate, SO3 must be sulfite. One less oxygen, same charge. Lithium sulfite. And finally here, we've taken phosphate, PO4, and we've put a hydrogen on it. We have to name all three of them, potassium, hydrogen, phosphate, three words. Yeah. Sulf is our prefix here, so that's uppercase, but that doesn't matter. Sulf is your root name, and we're going to do sulfate for the parent, sulfite for one less oxygen. Same charge. They're both minus two.
No, I'm talking about spelling, like S-U-L-P-H-A-T.
Yeah, well. That's British spelling or something?
Is that what I'm used to?
Yeah, okay. All right, let's do these backwards. Gonna do these just like the other ones, okay? Potassium, we know, is a group one element. It's gonna be a plus one. Sulfate, we know, without the P, is going to be a minus two cation, SO4. Therefore, we're going to do this as potassium plus one, sulfate minus two. In order to hit charge balance, how many potassiums do we need?
Two.
So how do we show this? We simply need K2 and then our sulfate SO4. Barium sulfite. If sulfate is SO4, sulfite is SO3. Right? Barium is in our second group, so it's a +2. Sulfite will be the same as sulfate, as charge-wise, so it will be a -2. We simply need one of each to make it neutral. Aluminum, a group 3 metal, is going to be a +3, isn't it? Remember, all the chlorine polyatomics are -1. Right? So here we have a +3 and a -1. To make it neutral, we need 3 of the chlorates. Now, how do you write that? What you do is you take chlorate, ClO3, put it in parentheses, and then put your subscript. So it looks like this. Aluminum +3, and we have 3 chlorates. ClO3 in parentheses, and then 3 of them. Silver nitrate. Now, silver is actually a transition metal, isn't it? But silver is always going to be +1. So don't worry about that. Silver is +1. Nitrate. Remember, our nitrogen polyatomics were -1. We simply put them together. Silver is Ag, nitrate is NO3, silver nitrate. And finally, barium. Barium is a group 2 metal. It will be a +2. Cyanide was the last polyatomic we looked at. Carbon and a nitrogen, triple bond, with a -1 charge. So we're going to need 2 cyanides for every barium. Remember, though, you have to put the whole polyatomic in parentheses. If we simply put BaCN2, that would say we have 2 nitrogens and a carbon. That's not right. We have 2 cyanides, 2 polyatomics. All right, any questions? Well, let's do a very simple exercise here. Look at these guys and come up with a name. Oops. These guys and come up with a name. This is simple. PB is lead. Fe is iron. So what would we call this guy? 1 lead, 1 oxygen. I have lead oxide, right? Now, our next one, we have a lead and 2 oxygens, but we don't use multipliers, do we? So what are we going to call this? Lead oxide. How about this guy? This is iron and oxygen. Iron oxide. And the next one, iron oxide. And the next one, iron oxide. Yet these are all different compounds. Clearly we have a problem here. That's because these guys are transition metals or heavy metals, and they could have various charges. The charges are referred to as oxidation numbers. Now I'm going to show you a slide about oxidation numbers that we're really not going to pay much attention to until we get to chapter 5. But we have to look at it very briefly. You look at it, you say, oh, and then move on. Oxidation number basically means the number of electrons you have added or taken away from a given element. Elements always start off at zero, so like aluminum. If we take 3 electrons away, its oxidation number would be 3. Simple concept. Magnesium bromide. We know this is +2, we know this is -1. We could put this in terms of oxidation numbers and say oxidation of magnesium is +2, bromine is -1. That's easy. Just the same as the charge. Lithium phosphide, +1, -3, oxidation number of +1. Oxidation number of -3. So that's the easy part, the same as the charge. Sometimes, however, you need to go a little bit deeper. Like I said initially, all pure elements are zero, and we have a set of rules. What you do with this set of rules in chapter 5 is start at the top and go down to identify oxidation numbers. What do you need to know in chapter 3? Oxygen is going to be -2. Halogens are going to be -1. Those are the only two things you need to remember now. Later we'll go through the whole chart and we'll see that oxygen is almost always -2. But again, that's chapter 5. All right, so let's look at our compounds. We said this was lead oxide, right? If the oxidation number of the oxygen is going to be -2, and this is neutral, what's the charge on our lead? Got to be +2. Here we have 2 oxygens. They're going to be -2 each. That's 4 negatives. What's the charge on the lead? Gotta be +4. That's pretty simple, isn't it? How do we work this into a name? Oh, okay, a couple more. We know that sulfate is going to be -2. What's the charge on the iron? To be neutral, it must be +2. Here we have 3 oxygens. That's 6 negatives, right? We have 2 irons. In order to balance out 6 negatives, each iron must be +3. Now, how do we work this into a name? What we're going to do is figure out the oxidation number, just like we did. Then we're going to put it in Roman numerals, immediately after the cation, in parentheses. So, here we said lead had to be +4, right? So we would write lead, 4, new word, oxide. No space here. Then we said lead must be +2. So we would simply write lead, 2, oxide.
Carbonate is minus 2. That means the iron must be plus 2. Iron 2, carbonate. And every bromine is going to be a minus 1. We have 3 of them. That means the iron must be plus 3. Iron 3, bromide. Any questions? Now, the moment you've all been waiting for. Yes, there are nomenclature tutorials. This guy, formulas to names. What you're going to do is look at the name, and you're going to type in look at the formula and type in the name. Doesn't matter if you use uppercase, lowercase. Just matters that you leave a space when you're supposed to. Barium. Well, barium is here in group 2, so we don't have to worry about the oxidation. It's going to be plus 2, right? So we would simply name this barium iodide. And we get it right. Copper. Now copper is right there. It's a transition metal. So we have to show the oxidation number. Iodine is going to be a minus 1. So the copper must be plus 1. So we need to write copper 1 iodide. One more. ClO. What's ClO? It's our parent minus 2 oxygens. So it's hypochlorite. Iron. Iron is a transition metal, so we have to show the Roman numeral. Chloride, hypochlorite is going to be minus 1. And we have 3 of them. That means the iron must be plus 3. So we will write iron 3 hypochlorite. Remember, as you write this, don't leave a space in between the metal and this guy. It will count it wrong. Any questions? All right, let's look at molecular compounds. These are actually even simpler than ionic because we use multipliers. So multipliers will tell us how many of each atom we have. In chemistry, we count monodi, tri, tetra, penta, hexa, hepta, octa, nona, deca. That's 1 to 10. The only rule is, if we only have one of our first element, we do not use mono. Otherwise, we're going to use a multiplier to say how many of each element we have. Look at some examples. CCO4. Our first word is simply the first element. What is that? Carbon, of course. So we're just going to write carbon. Remember, we do not use mono if there's only one of them. Our second one, we have 4 chlorines. How do we say 4? 4 is tetra. Carbon tetrachloride. Tetrachloride is one word, carbon is one word. Any questions? Quickly name this guy. One sulfur, two oxygens. First word is just the first element, that is sulfur. We don't use mono. Second word is going to be the oxygen. How many do we have?
Two.
How do we say two? Di. Sulfur dioxide. Two nitrogens, one oxygen. Well, we have two nitrogens. We have to put that in our name now. So we're going to begin with dinitrogen. Now we only have one oxygen, but it's our second word. Now we use mono. Dinitrogen monoxide. Now you may notice that there's a missing O. Monoxide as opposed to monoxide. That's because the Anglican tongue doesn't do well with two vowels together. So get rid of one. On an exam, I wouldn't care what you wrote. Tutorial will care. So try to remember that. Two nitrogens, five oxygens. Two nitrogens. Once again, this is going to be dinitrogen, isn't it? How do we say five? That's a pent. It's actually a penta, but because we have an oxygen there, we're going to drop the A, make it simply pentoxide. This is what it would be if we included them all. Too many vowels. Drop the A, pentoxide. On an exam, again, I'm not going to mess with you on dropping vowels and stuff, but the tutorial might. All right, look at this list. This is a real test question. Name these guys. First word is simply carbon, right? No mono. We have two oxygens, so it's a di. This is, of course, carbon dioxide. We have two hydrogens, so we have to use a multiplier. So this is going to be dihydrogen as our first word. Our second word, we have one sulfur, we have to use mono here. Dihydrogen, monosulfide. Here we put the O in. Dihydrogen, monosulfide. This is typically called hydrogen sulfide. Again, it's the rotten egg smell. One silicon, so our first word is going to be silicon. We have four hydrogens, so that's a tetra, and it's a hydride. One sulfur, no mono. Three oxygens,
trioxide.
One nitrogen, no mono, three chlorines, trichloride. Let's just throw in some fancier subscripts. Again, they're not difficult. Four is going to be what? Tetra. Six is hexa. So this is going to be tetraphosphorus hexasulfide. This is going to be diiodine. What, seven? Hepta. Drop the A, because AO again, drop the A. One oxygen, no mono, two fluorines, difluoride. One carbon, no mono, four hydrogens, tetrahydride. If you call this carbon tetrahydride, nobody would know what you're talking about. This is methane, organic compound, natural gas. And finally, tetrasulfur dinitride. Now, because we use multipliers everywhere, remember how much trouble we had with ionic compounds going from name back to formula? No problem here. This is dead out trivial. Write these down quickly. Fast as you can write. One nitrogen, three iodines, two phosphorus, five oxygens. One sulfur, three chlorines. One nitrogen, one oxygen. Just say no. One hydrogen, one chlorine, HCl. This is actually hydrochloric acid. There are special rules that we'll get to in chapter 8 for naming acids. NO is a really interesting compound. Back in the 80s or maybe 90s, I think, it was discovered inside living cells. And it earned the status of molecule of the year. Okay? That's interesting. Why is this stuff inside the cells? It's very, very reactive. It's there because, imagine this gas in the cell. If it gets touched on one end, it releases a burst of NO, which travels at the fusion control rate across the cell, interacts with other receptors, and so everybody knows you was just touched. Let's look at a couple more before we go. I think these are in your packet. We have two nitrogens, three oxygens. Again, formula to name. Two nitrogens, it's a dinitrogen. Three oxygen, it's a trioxide. One nitrogen, one sulfur. No mono, need a mono here. And we could also do this backwards. Now I want to show you this because you obviously can't do subscripts on this text field. So just put them in as regular numbers. This is going to be one sulfur, three bromines, and you would, or four bromines, sorry, and you would write it like that. We have sodium phosphate. Phosphate is going to be what charge? Minus three. So we need three sodiums to balance it out. And we would write it this way, Na3, PO4, all as one text field, and that's right. So we have covered three additional tutorials here. Naming ionics, naming molecular, and name the formula. That means we're up to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 55 potential points. Please make sure you do your tutorials. Any questions?